research, like everything else in life, changes, and it changes continually and perpetually. And what we need to try and do is think about ways in which we can stimulate the cutting edge work, which is really meant to define the future. And research in the end, you know, it's a people skill, it's a people issue, it's a brain issue. And so we need to invest in people to develop the leadership skills to try and produce that.
One of the reasons for doing this film and having a different kind of engagement with those who might be thinking about applying for the fellowship scheme is to try and demystify some of that concern around what leadership actually means in the arts and humanities. We haven't got a list of criteria where we're saying to reviewers, if they don't tick this box, then they're not a leader. What we're really looking to do is find a way in which the disciplines we support can think about the disciplinary context in which leadership might take place. That's to do with saying, I've got a leading research project, I've got an intellectual challenge that I want to pursue, and I need the time and resource to do that alongside other activities. It's giving people the time and resource to actually say, if I want to do more than the research project itself and find a way of enriching that research project, I need the support of the AHRC to help me deliver that.
There's no one single body of qualities which you can define, because projects are various and individuals are various, and you can think of examples across the piece of people who've handled these sorts of projects in a way which I think is impeccable and rewarding. When Venetia Porter did the Hajj exhibition, the wonderful Hajj exhibition at the British Museum, that stems from somebody having a vision of something which is increasingly important in our culture, and then having the wherewithal and the nous and the relationship building to try and develop that and realise it through a fantastic exhibition.
I think intellectual leadership in the arts and humanities can do two things. The first is that it can maintain and then extend the agenda that those kinds of disciplines have in the public imagination and in the political context. The other thing I think intellectual leadership in this field can do is something that is specific to arts and humanities. And that is that because of our relatively diffuse and sometimes ad hoc nature compared to other disciplinary types, we have in some ways a great deal of freedom to take some intellectual risks in understanding what we mean by discipline, in what we mean by collaboration, and in what we mean by intellectual contribution. And leadership is required to galvanise those efforts and to make sense of sometimes quite disparate conclusions and experiences. So I would say that on the one hand, it's an agenda-setting role, and on the other, it's expanding and indeed shaping the capacity of these disciplines to make profound intellectual contributions.
There's a great example at the University of West of England with Stephen Hoskins, who's developed a whole raft of work on 3D pots. And he's done this in collaboration with Denby Potteries to produce things which are really quite handsome artifacts. But the point is that they are pioneering cutting-edge research, responding to new opportunities, seeing where that might go, and being able to build those relationships and develop it.
My experience as a research leader began when I had an AHRC-funded research project on the League of Nations, and that led me to work with a couple of very gifted postdoctoral researchers and sort of delve into the League of Nations archives, which then had all sorts of consequences in different ways. It ended up, because there were more people that were interested in it, that the archive is now more accessible, the reading rooms are bigger, but it's also that it prompted me to help with a colleague in America to set up a network of researchers, because the publications and the conferences we were hosting generated interest, and we were sort of trying to work out what to do with that rather than just firing off the odd email here and there. So we established a network online, so we have a kind of research presence in that way.
You need a bit of a reputation to be able to lead. And I think the critical feature of leadership for me is not directing. It's actually simply being part of the team. And you're communicating your experience, but people are then working independently. So I think the critical thing is you don't have people on a team who think they're doing dog's body jobs on your behalf as the leader.
I think Simon Kay's work on the Porter's project, for instance, is terrific. What's interesting about that is the logistics which lie underneath it. He's had to put together this grant and that grant. He's had to liaise between this body and that body. And so those kinds of organisational and craft skills in terms of the research, those have been really, really well illustrated by him.
And I think where the kind of the leadership experience has come in has actually been trying to provide direction. It's also been trying to raise the profile, keep the profile of the project in the academic eye and in the public eye. And it's also been in trying to use the project as a way of giving experience to younger researchers and helping essentially breed the next generation of archaeologists that are going to be interested in this kind of thing.
As arts and humanities researchers, we work in a multiplicity of ways, alone in the library, out in conferences, sometimes as part of large teams. The real benefit of leadership is knowing what's the right stance to take when, helping to shape a discipline, but also a group of people. It's also about standing back and bringing people together and helping them develop their own ideas, actually lowering your own voice in order to hear a multiplicity of voices.
We tend often to think about the leadership skills that are required in leading large, multidisciplinary, collaborative projects, and that of course is very important. But there's another type of research leadership which we, as one might associate with what we've often called and misleadingly called the lone scholar. The point about the lone scholar, of course, is that they're never lone. The form of research leadership which is challenging existing interpretations, sort of revisionist scholarship, or opening up a very new and different perspective on an apparently familiar subject, or even almost bringing a whole new field of research inquiry into existence, may not require a large multidisciplinary cross-institutional team to deliver that, but the whole genesis of that book has required them to engage with many different scholars, perhaps from different countries, different disciplines, with different sort of perspectives on their subject.
Leadership around a project has to involve that you share values with each other, so whether it's methodological, theoretical, or ethical, or all three, and also working through what are a lot of tensions that are there around disciplinary boundaries itself. So to kind of iron out and also assure people that it's taking on board the different perspectives. So that value sharing is quite intrinsic.
No one is pretending that this is easy for researchers. It's not easy for us as a funder. But actually, part of the richness of what we're trying to achieve is the challenge. How do we define research leadership? There are going to be 101 different examples of that. But that's part of the rich context in which arts and humanities research actually takes place.